Hello and welcome to Enchantment of Eternity's review for the Survivors, which is episode 3 of season 3 of Star Trek The Next Generation. This video is part of a series of videos where I review episodes of Star Trek as determined by my user polls. The episode to win my latest user poll, which was just for Next Generation episodes, was The Survivors. So, The Survivors is the episode where the Enterprise encounters a planet, a Federation colony, which has been completely destroyed, save for one house and two survivors. So, Picard investigates this mystery, and while investigating the mystery, it seems like they're just two normal elderly couple who happen to survive. They seem normal, nothing wrong with them. And Troy starts experiencing telepathic pain, in which he has to go into a coma for. And then the alien ship that attacked the colony keeps returning, but Picard starts to figure it out that the ship is responding to the wishes of the elderly gentleman, Kevin Oxbridge. And eventually he deduces that Kevin Oxbridge did in fact die, in which his wife Rashaan did die in the attack, but Kevin is a very powerful being that somehow survived and was recreating his wife and recreating the ship in order to try to scare the Enterprise away, and that he was responsible for causing the damage to Counselor Troy. So he fixes the damage to her and admits that he killed the entire alien species everywhere in known existence and retribution for killing his wife, something that he deeply regrets. But Picard says that he's not capable of punishing him for that sort of crime, so lets him leave. So I really like this episode. I put this in my top 10 Next Generation episodes, and I had a lot of people question it. This isn't an episode you would commonly see in a top 10, although I have found a few other people that do agree with me that this is a really great episode, but it's not a very common opinion. It's not like yesterday's Enterprise or The Inner Light or something where everyone agrees it's one of the best episodes of Next Generation. In fact, when I did my top 10 countdown, I got several comments of like, "The Survivors, what the, this countdown is invalid. Why would the hell would you put The Survivors on there?" But I really stand by my statement. Now, this is a mystery episode, and I think probably, to my recollection, it is the best mystery episode of the Star Trek franchise. And that is, it presents a mystery, and our characters, particularly Picard, try to solve it. Now, there's the other episode I can think of that was a strong mystery episode was Clues, which is another episode that I think is underrated in Next Generation, and I would probably put that in my top 20. Even though it didn't quite crack my top 10. And that's another episode that seems not very well loved the way I love it. So maybe I just have a thing for mystery episodes. I mean, I suppose you could call Ship in a Bottle a mystery, but I don't know if I would. Maybe a little bit. It's definitely not as straightforward as a mystery as this is. Like, Aquiel is another, that was a straightforward mystery, but that was a bit, I liked it more than most people do. Most people would say it was one of the worst episodes of the show. I don't think it's one of the worst episodes of the show, but it's not nowhere near one of the best either. It's a bit too by-the-numbers cliche mystery. And then you got some ones in Voyager that are quite horrible, like Ex Post Facto, which is terrible. So I think when Star Trek tends to do mystery episodes, they don't do a particularly good job. I suppose you could call Matter of Perspective a mystery episode, but I think of that more as a trial episode, but either way. And that episode was okay. But The Survivors, I think, is, to me, because it's a mystery that's unique to Star Trek. It's not, oh, who did it? The butler killed someone or whatever. You're in the house and someone got murdered. Who's the murderer? It's a lot more unique and sci-fi than that. And it's a unique situation where the Enterprise comes across this planet, which apparently was destroyed by an alien attack, yet there's perfectly square piece of grass amidst like a ruined planet, and there's like a perfectly structured house with two old people living in it. So that's an interesting mystery to me. And I love how the mystery unfolds. Not just a resolution, because I think some people are unhappy with the resolution of it. I wasn't. But the way it unfolds. Now, this is also, I think, the reason why a lot of people may not like this episode. It is a low-key, almost bottle show. Because they do go, it's not technically, because they do go on location. They go to the location of the house for Kevin Ochsberg. And a lot of people tend to hyper-focus on the scene where Riker gets, hanged upside down by this trap in Kevin's front yard, which does look a bit silly, I guess, but I don't think it's, like, over-the-top cheesy. I don't really have an issue with it. I think it kind of contributes to the kind of demeanor that Kevin has, that he wants to be left alone. And so I think, but what I focus more on is the scenes with Picard. Because this, I've referred to this before as the Picard, or not the Picard, this isn't who watches The Watchers, that's the next episode. Now, I refer to this as Picard is the Man episode. And it's definitely, because this is, I think, one of his strongest episodes. Like, if someone, I said Picard is my favorite starship captain of all Star Trek. Even though Next Gen's not my favorite, Deep Space Nine's my favorite, but if I were to pick a captain, I would go with Picard. And if someone asked me why, I would say, watch The Survivors. This, to me, is a prime example of what makes Picard so awesome. Because I love, because he doesn't precisely know what he's going on, but you get the sense that he is two steps ahead of everyone else in this crew. Even Riker, which to some degree I think they played Riker a little dumb in this episode, just to showcase how smart Picard was. But and I love the very calm and calculated way Picard goes about testing his theories and unraveling the mysteries, because he can tell that something is up with Kevin and Roshana Ochsberg and things aren't what they appear to be, and he keeps testing things, sometimes even putting the Enterprise at risk, and Riker's like, oh sir, blah blah blah, we're gonna be destroyed, and Picard's like, nah, shut up, just calm down and just do nothing, we'll be fine. And Picard, of course, turns out to be 100% correct. So this is Picard is the Man. The Picard is the Man episode. That is absolutely, it's amazing. And it's like, because as I said, he doesn't know that Kevin Ochsberg was this entity or being. He eventually figures it out, though, before Kevin reveals it. Because he tests the theory, because he sees that the Hoosnock ship is responding directly to Kevin's wishes. So he goes down, he gives him, he puts a perfectly good, test, where tells Kevin, he makes it clear to him that the only way that the Enterprise will leave orbit, which is what Kevin really wants the whole time, is just like, go away, leave us alone, go away, go away. And this time he's like, alright, the only thing that's going to make us go away is if you die. Yeah, if you don't die, then we're going to stay here forever. And so, on cue, Hoosnock's ship shows up, and Riker's like, oh, put up the shields, attack it, blah, blah. And Picard's like, calm down. We're not, just calm, slow your roller there, Riker. We're not going to do anything. We're just going to sit back and chill. Sure enough, Hoosnock's ship goes straight for the Kevin Ochsberg's house, blows it up, and then Picard's like, okay, fire phaser, and the ship's like easily destroyed. And then Picard goes to Riker's like, okay, so what reason do we have to stay here? And Riker's like, well, Kevin Ochsberg and Roshan are dead, the ship's destroyed, there are no survivors, so we have absolutely no reason to stay here. And Picard's like, very good, number one, maintain orbit, and just goes, fucks off in his ready room. That's amazing. I absolutely love that. And sure enough, they maintain high orbit, so they're hidden, so that Kevin couldn't see them. And you gotta think, how Kevin's powers, how could he not see them? But anyway, and you hear, you get a scene of, like, I think Wesley and Data, I think, or maybe even Worf were bitching about, or Worf, I think, was bitching too. It's like, why are we staying here? This is a waste of time, blah, blah, blah. So I guess they're portrayed kind of as idiots too. But, I mean, maybe I'm being a bit unfair to them because this is a very unusual situation, and so Picard is sort of thinking on a higher level, so maybe I should just give him more credit, whereas Worf and Wesley and all of them, Riker, just thinking how they would normally behave in a normal situation. They forget they're in a weird sci-fi show. But anyway, so there, the house reappears, Kevin and Roshan and Alex Bridger are magically alive, and Picard, like, you know, beams them on board against their wishes and, like, flat out. This is when he figured it out. When they magically appear, he's like, boom, Roshan, you're not real. That actually shocked me. Like, I didn't know that. I definitely knew that something was up with Kevin, but I did not know that that she was just a recreation that Kevin made and that the real Roshan died. And that was such a powerful moment, especially the scene where Kevin's confessing after he heals Counselor Troy, and he's confessing his crimes. And I like how when he said, you know, that he refused to fight, but Roshan did, and she died, and he was upset, so he killed the Hushnok, and Dr. Crusher was kind of oblivious. She's like, oh, so why did you try to lie to us? Is it because you were ashamed of not fighting and letting Colonist die? Like, she didn't seem to care that he killed the Hushnok. She seemed to think, like, oh, he killed it because, I guess we're assuming, because I was assuming as well, she's assuming that he killed the one Hushnok ship, or however many ships that had an orbit of this one planet, and that's it, the ones in orbit. I killed the Hushnok. And so she actually didn't see anything wrong with him, which I don't know about that. Because, I mean, sure, these Hushnok killed all the colonists, but she seemed to brush past the fact that he just killed, like, instantly killed, even if she thought it was just a few ships, that she just instantly snuffed them out, even after, because he wasn't protecting anyone at that point, because all the colonists were already dead. So he was doing it more out of vengeance. So the fact that she didn't blink an eye out of it, I don't know, I kind of question. But he's like, no, 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 you don't understand. I didn't kill just a couple Hushnok or 100 or 1,000. I killed all Hushnok everywhere. And it's something he absolutely deeply regret it, and that's when the reality of it sinks in. And I like Picard's reaction. Picard's reaction here was really cool because he knew that Kevin Oxbridge was a being far beyond his control, and he's like, "I can't hold you because there's no way they could actually hold him in a prison cell unless he volunteered to do so," which he may have. But Picard took the other route, saying like, "We don't have any crimes." Any laws to cover your crimes, which I don't think is true. Because even with modern technology, modern in this area, surely someone could wipe out an entire race, which is called xenocide. I know that from the Ender books. It's not genocide, it's xenocide. So this should be a crime for xenocide, which is basically what he committed. But he knew, Picard knew, that he couldn't cover his, you know. And that was a powerful scene. Like, I think this whole episode, like, the guest actor that they had to play Kevin and Roshan, really great. And the scene in particular with Crusher, Picard, and Kevin was a really well-acted scene. And this is what I'm saying. Most of this episode comprises of just dialogue scenes. And if you know me, my taste, I say this a lot on my channel, like some of my favorite episodes of DS9, like Duet and The Pale Moonlight, which are just mostly comprised of people sitting in a room talking. And that's my favorite kind of episode. And that, to me, is more impressive for a writer, a movie, a TV show to come up with a very engaging, very thought-provoking story that keeps you so on the edge of your seat and so engaged and consist almost entirely of just two people talking. To me, that's a lot more impressive than using fancy cinematography or special effects or fighting scenes or whatever. Just dialogue based. I guess it's very theater based, and this scene in particular felt very theater-ish. But is that able to captivate you with dialogue? And I think the whole way the whole episode unfolds is actually quite beautiful. Has to say that the mystery of it keeps you really engaging. And I was like, when I first saw this episode, I was completely questioning what the hell was going on. And I think the whole structure of it, like, builds, like, it never drags at all. It always comes along because you see Picard's evolution of slowly starting to catching on to what's really going on. And I think that's really, really impressive to see. And I think the ending resolution has a quite powerful punch to it. It's very dark and very makes you think, like, that we're dealing with, like, the destruction of a whole Federation colony. And how he said how he tried to stop the Hushnak by tricking them the same way he tried to trick Picard, and it just didn't work. It just made them more pissed off. So it made it worse. What really is interesting is that he's a pacifist who refuses to kill. Mainly because he knows he's way powerful than human beings and is able to kill very easily. So the only thing that tempers him is like this strong pacifist notion. But in that one moment where the woman he loved, I wouldn't say his whole life because he's probably hundreds of years old, but her whole life, to be sure, for his whole human existence anyway, that she was killed and that he went insane and wiped out, like, in a moment of rage. Like, not even, I imagine this is more instinctual than it was intentional. Like, he didn't clearly think in his mind, I'm going to wipe out the entire species of Hushnak. It was probably more like, what was going through his mind was probably like, Aah! It was like a rage. And because he's such a powerful being, as an instinct of that, an extension of that rage, was his anger was directed towards the entire species of Hushnak and it wiped them out, and that he never actually consciously thought to do it. It just was an extension of reaction of seeing his wife dead. And it's obvious how deeply he regretted that, and now how that's why he was so desperate to try to get the Enterprise to go away, because he did not want to find that. And of course he's back to his rational thinking self, who refuses to kill people. Now, not necessarily refuses to harm people, because what he did to Council of Troy was actually quite harmful, and I'll touch on that more in a second. So he's willing to harm people to an extent, but definitely not kill them. Like, the Enterprise was never any real danger, because he still has a strong sense of ethics that refused it, and he wouldn't want to compound what he did already. He just wants to hide from it. He's ashamed, because I don't think he's worried that he's going to get arrested or executed or anything like that. He's ashamed. He feels this deep shame over what he did that will haunt him for the rest of his life, and they make that clear. And I think that's also part of the reason why Picard just lets him go. Because he knows that whatever punishment Picard could give him is insignificant compared to the punishment he's going to unleash on himself. That the massive guilt that he's going to feel the rest of his life for doing what he did. And this is just such a well-structured... such a powerful punch for such a good mystery story that was just well developed. Now, Kevin Oxbridge's power is like a lot. Some people equate him to Q, but I think he's definitely less powerful than Q. I wouldn't say he's nearly as powerful as Q. I didn't research. I know there's a lot of like powerful godlike beings that have appeared throughout Star Trek, particularly the original series had a whole bunch, Next Generation. So, and I would put Kevin Oxbridge more on par with some of the ones that appeared in the original series. Definitely not as omniscient as Q. And so some people might think, why didn't Kevin just bring the Hushnok back to life like he brought Rashaan back to life? But I think they made it very clear in this episode that that wasn't really Rashaan. Because if it was Q, Q could snap his fingers and Rashaan would actually be alive. That would actually be her. It wouldn't be a recreation or an illusion. It would be her. She'd be alive again. But I get the impression when Kevin does it, that isn't actually her. It is a recreation. It is an illusion. You could say it's a living being, but it's just an imitation. It's like a copy of her, and I think he makes that clear. Like, is how quickly she vanishes as soon as Picard points it out to her, which is why he still is depressed, because even though Rashaan's there with him, that's not really Rashaan. He lost the real Rashaan. The real Rashaan is dead. And so who he's living with is just a secondhand copy, if you will. And so he still misses the real Rashaan. So if he recreated, there would be, so in that point, there would be no point in him recreating the Hushnok, because the real Hushnok are already dead. There's nothing he can do about it. So if he recreated the Hushnok, it would just be an illusion. And I suppose he could try to do that to ease his conscience, because maybe the Hushnok have, other people that will miss them or whatever. But as they're described here, the Hushnok is a very violent species. So if he recreated them, they'll probably just go around killing more people. So it would bring about more destruction, and it wouldn't actually be them, because the real Hushnok are dead. So it would just be these imitation copies that are going around killing people. So that would actually make the galaxy a worse place, and would not at all undo his crime of killing them all, because they would all still be dead. So there would be no point in it. There would be no point in recreating the Hushnok. But I think maybe the flaw of this episode is how Kevin seems to be so powerful and can control so much, and yet he never seemed to be able to tell when the Enterprise was in orbit. It seems like something like when Picard would beam down to the planet, he'd always be shocked to see him. But if he's this powerful, he should fucking know. And also, if he's this powerful, couldn't he just screen like his little house from the sensors of the ship? Maybe like the first time the Enterprise comes, he wasn't aware they were coming. But once he was aware, you think that he would be able to render his house and Rashaan invisible, rather than have it just be there so Picard can just stroll in whenever he likes. I don't know. I don't know. Maybe his powers are kind of what they are to fit the plot. But I don't know. I think it still really works. Now, let me talk about Counselor Troi. Because I've heard a lot of people complain about this aspect of this episode. But I actually like it. I actually think it's really good, as a matter of fact. I think it adds to the mystery aspect of it. It definitely deepens the intrigue of that something's totally off. And it is Picard's actually main motivation for staying, for investigating Kevin. Because if it wasn't for Troi, he would be like, after he figured out that Kevin was just this powerful being that wanted to be left alone, Picard wouldn't see any reason not to. He'd be like, okay, fine, whatever, I'll leave you alone. But, because I don't think he, even though he might want to satisfy his curiosity, I don't think he would. I don't think he would have pushed it as far. And I think he even says as much in the end of the episode, that the reason why he's still here is because one of his crewmates is still suffering, and he needs Kevin to fix it. So it was a deep, not only did it really deepen the mystery of how something was really off, but it also was a huge motivation for Picard to uncover this mystery. And plus, why Kevin does this to her in the first place, I think, makes complete and utter sense. Total sense. Like, and this is a good use of Counselor Troi's empathic powers, because, as we know, a lot of Next Generation episodes will forego her powers and make them a lot weaker than what they should be for the purposes of the plot. But this plot actually has them be as powerful as ascribed and uses that. Because, I mean, one might say, well, why couldn't Troi just read Kevin's mind and figure out that he's more? Because she can tell when Q is there. Well, like, when she always senses Q, she always, like, this is a very powerful being. And, like, she can sense that sort of thing, that someone's, like, that powerful, that amount of control. Now, you may think, well, how come she didn't sense this of Kevin immediately? Because when the Enterprise first got there, she wasn't incapacitated until a bit later. But I think that actually makes sense, because Kevin had renounced his powers and had totally converted to a human and was trying not to use his powers, which is why they used that silly contraption trap thing to trap Riker rather than him using like a powerful energy being or whatever, is because he was trying to completely be human and renounce his powers and just live his life in peace with his wife. But the Enterprise interfering is when he had to start using his powers more, and by so that stage, that's when he's, in fact, I do believe in disabling Counselor Troi was the first thing he did, using his powers, and so not just being human. So that's the first thing he did. So before he did any of the other things, like recreate the Husnock ship or recreate their little house, recreate Rashaan, like the first thing they did was disable Counselor Troi. So she was already disabled by the time he started using her powers more. And you could tell when she first started getting incapacitated, she was sensing there was something off. And that scene in the ready room, actually, I mean, not the ready room, the conference room, whatever they call it, that was so well done. That was such a beautiful scene, because Picard and the senior staff were all talking like normal, and Troi was just like really distracted. She couldn't concentrate. She was freaking out. She would just hear the music. And then Picard's like, "Are you okay?" She's like, "Yeah, I'm fine." But there's something about Kevin. And so she started thinking about Kevin and Rashaan, trying to describe them. But the more she did that, the louder the music got, and the more pain she was in, and the more distracted she was, which I thought was, as I said, that's so well done. And I do give Marina Sirtis all the credit here. Her acting was amazing. I think people bash on her unnecessarily, honestly. So many people say she's a bad actress, and I really don't think so. I think most of the time she's fine, but this is in the case I think she does a really good job. I think she was amazing in this episode, particularly playing that. Now, as for the specifics of what he does to her, is by having a piece of music replay in her mind. Now, I hear some people think that, oh, that's a bit silly, that you wouldn't go insane or whatever, because we all had that. And then Picard even says this in this episode, oh, we all had that tune that we can't get out of our heads and it's a bit annoying. But this is taking it to an extreme level beyond what any real life human being has actually experienced, because it's constant, never goes away. Even though when you get something stuck in your head, it may feel like it never goes away, but you do have instances, you have moments, and sometimes hours pass without hearing the song. But so it's hard to imagine what it'd be like if it was completely constant, like never went away for a second. And even follows her in her dreams. And that's when she starts to get really bad. And plus, I think the production side of it did a great job, because the music gets louder as well. Like, this is a very effective, I think, some of the best creepy scenes in all of Next Generation. Like, I would put this above, like, episodes like Genesis or whatever, to try to be horror. Or don't even get me started on Sub Rosa. That's just, ugh. But this is a really effective horror scene, a really effective creepy scene where she's in her quarters and the music is just so loud. She's like walking back and forth and she's like in tears and she's like in extreme pain. The crusher's like trying to help her, but nothing she can do seems to help. And she's like, I can induce sleep. And she's like, as well, not even the deepest dreams will follow you. And she's like, it's not a dream, it's real. Like, that was just such an intense scene. I gotta strongly disagree with people who thought this is a weak part of the episode. I thought this is actually a strong part of the episode. I think this definitely enhanced the overall mystery because it really gave that much more motivation and that much more intensity to it. It wasn't just, oh, what's the deal with the two old people who are still alive? No, it's more than that. It's like the hell that Counselor Troy is going through, like, is directly connected to that. So it really intensifies, and as I said, it gives Picard the motivation, and that eventually they just have to put her in a coma. And I do wonder, since we do learn that this music she's experiencing is telepathic in nature, that if it followed her even into the coma, like, that's a horrific thought. That I, from what I understand, you don't, being in a coma is different than being asleep. Like, you don't experience anything. But what if that music transcended that? That's a horrific thought to me. That this music never goes away, ever. And it's constantly, and it keeps getting louder and never stops. Like, I don't know. I think that is extremely horrific. So I think this was probably the most effective, like, horror scenes, or at least creepy, outright, like, creepy. And I love it. I think it really, really enhances the episode. So, and has a, we get a few other side plots, such as Worf, like, saying, oh, they won't get away from me, and I can find them, and Picard kind of is like, oh, Mr. Worf, you fucked up. But then later in the episode, Worf is like, oh, I'm sorry, sir, and he's like, no, don't worry, Worf, it wasn't you, because by that time he figured out it was, you know, Kevin was recreating things that wasn't him. So that was a pretty interesting side plot to it. And Kevin Rashan hasn't said the scenes with them on the planet. Of course, got to mention, like, the classic line where Worf goes down and he's sitting there. And you see Worf slumped in a chair, sipping his tea, which is a very funny thing to say, to see, really. And it's because, you know, Picard went down there, he wanted to have security with him, but he wanted to appear as if he was unimposing. So we don't see it on screen, but I wouldn't be surprised if he, like, ordered Worf to try to be, like, relaxed and put up a relaxed atmosphere to try to relax Kevin and Rashan. and I think that actually would have added to the episode if they did have a scene like that, because Worf is sitting there sipping his tea and Rashan's like, oh, what do you think? He's like, good tea, nice house. And that's like, that's a classic Worf line. It's something I know a lot of people point out. Something about it is just really funny. And it's probably because, you know, he's this huge muscle impending, like, warrior Klingon type. But obviously he's in a situation where Picard wants him to make nice and be relaxed so he can try to get more information out of it. So he's just like, good tea, nice house, because he's so bad at doing it like that, and he's so awkward in those kind of social situations too. It's very un-Klingon like, and but he's doing it to try to fulfill his duty to Picard. He wants to do his captain's wishes, but he's just so awkward in the moment, he can't help it. And I love it. It is, I think, a very noteworthy part of the episode. So anyway, my rating for The Survivors out of 10 is a 10, the best. I think this is an amazing episode. It's criminally underrated. This episode is actually such a well-structured mystery that keeps you engaged throughout. The scenes with Counselor Troy are very creepy and horrific, that add to the mystery and keep you that much engaged that much more interested to figure out what's going on. And then you get Picard's journey as he slowly starts to unravel. And it really shows you the kind of intelligence. And it's really fascinating to see Picard at work, for him to put the pieces together, put theories, have hypotheses, test them, see them pan out, and then finally figure everything out, where he corners Kevin and gets him to admit something that he desperately didn't want to admit to everyone, and to see the weight of that revelation come. And this is all played in dialogue. Like, we never actually see the Husnak kill the colonists. We never actually see Rashaan die. We never actually see the Husnak at all, let alone see them all wiped out. But this is done through great acting. And to me, that's even more powerful than physically seeing it. You know, a lot of people will say, and when it comes to TV and movies, it's a visual medium. We're supposed to see things. Show, don't tell. That's the common thing. They always say show, don't tell. In a lot of cases, I think that is the case when you have some amateur story writings where they just, well, as you know, and then they explain things instead of actually showing it to us. But I think a lot of people take that too far and think, oh, you're always supposed to show us instead of tell us. Because sometimes when you have amazing performances where you see, because we actually are being shown, we're being shown the emotion that how this affects Kevin, and seeing Picard's reaction. So seeing that this story unfold through dialogue rather than physically seeing, like, the Husnak being destroyed, or even them, they might have, if they had like a huge budget, maybe they would have flashbacks or visuals where you can see this while Kevin is saying his narrative. And I think this is better. Honestly, I think it's better not to see it. I think it's better to have it explained to us through this amazing performance that I just, as a lost art, I think. And I think this is even more impressive than using the cheat of having cool visuals, personally. Anyway, that is it for my review of The Survivors. Thank you so much for watching this. Be sure to check out my channel for more Star Trek reviews, and also I cover many other shows like The Expanse, Mr. Robot, Lost, and more. So be sure to subscribe so you can keep up with all that. Thanks a lot for watching.